Hey everyone, it's Mark Sargent, and this is Flat Earth Q&A emails 12, and let's just get right to it. Email is from, there's no name, just says getting it done God free. Hey dude, my name's Kel, just want to pick your brains a little. Now I have seen and completely realized how much of an illusion it really is in this world since I started on this path over 12 years ago. Now I am 29, I have heard all about this flat earth a few times by believers, but I never took to it. What is your most obvious fact or argument that shatters the planet theory? Why didn't the early explorers figure it out, or at least there would have been more writings of this? I am now on a mission to look into this. It's funny how we ignore some subjects. Thank you, dude. Well, Kel, the most obvious argument, you know, there's not any one given that really cements the whole thing. It's a combination of stuff. For me, it is, you know, some of the things that I touched on in the clues, plus some things I didn't touch on in the clues, which the community started figuring out for themselves. You know, I started off with, you know, Antarctica and Admiral Byrd and the Apollo missions and everything that NASA was doing, the Van Allen radiation belts, and all the stuff, the proof, how should I put this? It's not that, if you treat this like a court case, it's not that we are absolutely proving the flat earth is real. What we're really doing is putting massive reasonable doubt in the globe. That's what I try to harp people, because that's what how everyone starts. They try to say that flat earth isn't real because there's all this proof for the globe, and then they go looking for proof of the globe and they can't find it. That's or so unbelievably thin and weak that it becomes ridiculous. I mean, there should be massive, huge stacks of overwhelming evidence in the globe, and there isn't. It's the exact opposite. It's just a few pieces of packing popcorn in an empty box. We're saying, oh, well, there was something there. It was big and it was wrapped in all a bunch of packing popcorn. It's like, well, not only is the object not there, but most of the popcorn's not there either. So, you know, that's what I'd first look into. Look into NASA. Look at all the images and everything that NASA and the Russian Space Agency and the European Space Agency and Japanese and Indian and China, look at all what they've been putting forward for the last 60 years. And tell me it is absolutely a guarantee of the Earth being a globe. That and, of course, no, the big thing that which wasn't in the clues, which was that there's no curvature. No one can find any curvature on the ground. In fact, the only people that ever take pictures of the curvature, with the exception of some high altitude balloons with fisheye lenses, is NASA or the space agencies. Nobody on the ground ever sees any curvature, and we, you know, forward and backwards, we should see, especially with the vertical drop in elevation, we should see some sort of indication, and we can't. Find me an object that at a certain distance, a lighthouse or a tower or something, some high object from a distance that you cannot see with any optics. The technology for zoom, once you zoom in, you can always see it. There's never an object that some scientist should come out and say, well, there's this object that's 30 miles away that you shouldn't be able to see because of the curvature of the Earth. And you know what? You can't. You can never see it. And people go out there with cameras and get really frustrated. It's like, oh, can't see it, you know, even with 70 power zoom. That never happens. It's the exact opposite. We can always see it. You know, 100 miles, 120, 140 miles away, we can see the stuff. So that's the thing convinces me most right now anyway. So the question I put back to you is, prove to me it's a globe. There you go. Next email is from Thomas Wright. Hello, Mark. I feel as I know you, having watched so many of your enclosed Earth videos. You are obviously a very bright guy with a fine command of the English language. Keep up the good work. I recently picked up on this story of a Taiwanese woman who gave birth on a flight from Taipei, Taiwan to Los Angeles, California. Yes, any good flat earther knows this story. For health reasons, the pilot diverted to Anchorage, Alaska, where the woman was taken to a local hospital. I am sure you are aware of the story, but I recently relayed the story to a friend who thinks I'm nuts for believing this flat earth shit, his words. When I pointed out how ridiculous this diversion would be given a globe and how reasonable it was on a flat earth, he said he was sure the pilot had a very good reason for stopping in Alaska. Question: how do I demonstrate the difference in miles, since the only mileage I can get is published as a global model? That's a tough one. For example, I found the distance from Taipei to Los Angeles to be 6,789, and Taipei to Anchorage at 4,657 on a so-called globe. But the Flat Earth model shows the flight going right past Alaska without any real diversion to speak of. How do I compute the real mileage? Am I making my point? Real quick on that one. It's not that the flight... Yeah, if the flight was going straight from Taipei to Anchorage, that'd be one thing. But it should have been going straight towards Hawaii. The point is, and you're leaving out Hawaii in this equation here, which a lot of people do, which is... there are a lot more people in Hawaii, a lot better hospitals, and they cater to the, you know, Asian people do a lot of vacationing in Hawaii. The whole thing's set up for them. Anchorage, Alaska, it's set up for nobody in particular. You know, there is not a lot of people up there. I mean, you have, remember, Alaska is one of the few states that actually pays people, in fact, maybe the only one that pays people to live there every year. So... you know, look at that first. Look how far the flight went, like it was heading towards Los Angeles, and then diverted up. What I'm saying is, and what a lot of other people should be saying, is it should have gone to Hawaii. It should have gone to Honolulu or Kauai or whatever. It should have gone there, and it didn't. It went north, north by northeast until it got to Anchorage, Alaska. And I know on a globe, it, you know, it looks, it makes it a lot easier, but it's like, no, it shouldn't have been that close to it. Anyway, another question. I know Antarctica is off limits, but since we hit ice, no matter which latitudinal line we choose, which circumnavigates the map, how can the entire distance be guarded? On a globe, all latitudinal lines end up at the same place, not so on our flat map. Get my point. But since we hit ice, no matter what, how can the entire distance be guarded? Oh, yeah, multinational navy. That's the easiest way. That, and of course, you know, that most of it's done by natural negative reinforcement, which is that it gets colder and colder until you get icebergs, and then when you get there, you know, it's a steep incline, you know, from 200 feet on the shore all the way up to 2 miles high. It's a very hostile place. So, you know, 99.999% of the population doesn't ever want to go there. You know, even the vacation trips, you want to go there now, it's going to cost you 10, 15 grand, and that's just to get to the peninsula and take pictures with penguins. So, it's guarding it is not as tough as you might think. You know, radar systems have gotten better, but you would need a multinational to do it. You know, the United States isn't going to foot the bill for everything. Let's see, he ends the email with, I am a virtual newbie at this whole concept, but have bought into it 100%. I still have lots of questions, but you and Rob Skiba are my mentors. Thanks for the tutelage. I've not used that word in a while. I always knew there was something wrong with the NASA business, but never suspected such massive dishonesty. Thank God the Donald is stepping to get rid of some of the crap. Oh boy. I would not be surprised if he blew the whole cover up, would you? God bless you, Mark. Tom Wright from Houston, Texas. I don't know if Donald Trump's going to do anything there. Yeah, remember, he still has to answer to the people that bought him the election in the first place. There are people behind him. He did not just come into this on his own. And also, don't forget, a little side note about Donald Trump, if you don't believe that he would, you know, maybe compromised already, he was the guy that was leading the charge against the Obama birth certificate issue. And he was the one, you know, rallying the flags, blowing the trumpets, and saying that, oh yeah, you know, the Obama's, you know, shouldn't be here, blah blah blah. Wouldn't have been interesting if they went to him and said, okay, fine, you got us. Here's what we're gonna do. You want to run for president? We can't guarantee you're gonna win, but we can get you to the finals. And if you do that, of course, you know, you still have to answer to the military-industrial complex. I believe, and that question came up on Patricia's show recently, which was, you know, who did I think the last president with any power was? And I think it was Dwight D. Eisenhower. President Kennedy had a little power, sure, but he didn't have any backing. There was nobody backing. By that time, the military-industrial complex was in full swing. That complex is what runs the world right now. Make no mistake. The presidents now are just puppets. They're just voices, frontmen in a band. And they can't do anything on their own. So Donald, yeah, he can say all he wants, but he's got to answer to a whole bunch of people. Again, it's the illusion of choice. It is, we are given, you know, Democrats and Republicans to choose from. It gives you some sort of sense of power, but they're both controlled. And I'll go into that much, much later. All right, so Chris Cox writes, What is critics? The world you live in, the layman's. Oh boy, this is big. All right, you know what? Let's read some of this. Sure, why not? The World You Live In, A Layman's Manual to the Earth, Issue 1 by Chris Cox. The Flat Earth, Welcome to the Dream Chamber. With the increased access to information all over the world, the reality of the weakness in the globe theory and all the institutions based on it is beginning to come to fruition. Soon the fact that the Earth plane that we live on is not a planet will be common knowledge as it was many years before. What? It's okay, because check this out. Now you can ask yourself a few simple questions and perhaps find the beginnings of a new peace of mind. There is another very important fact to add to your new Flat Earth model. That is the cosmic microwave background. According to this model, which has been thoroughly verified with mathematics, all the visible light in the universe originated on Earth. That deserves its own sentence. All the visible light in the universe originated from Earth. So if we combine these two facts, that the Earth plane is flat and that all light originated from here, then we have a very magical event on hand. This means that the Big Bang was real and that we are the Big Bang. Now is the time one must take a deep breath and ask the truth within themselves a few more questions. Two, there are magnets and temperature changes. That's it. Keep it simple. What we mean to say here is that there is no such thing as gravity. Gravity is a made-up term for something that was much easier to explain. The reality of our existence is based on magnets and temperature. Interesting. Magnetic energy is an invisible energy that exists within all objects. Objects that can carry a greater magnetism are recognized as such and often called magnetic. The reality is that all things are magnetic. Magnetic energy flows through all things. Some things it flows through in greater amounts. Magnetic energy contains electrons running in overpowering streams so that nearly susceptible metals will attract to try and grab these electrons. Both things want the magnetic energy, and once they find it, won't let go. So they bind to the energy and stick together. Hot goes up, cold goes down. Here on Earth, heat rises. The Earth is much warmer than the surrounding space, thus we are rising through space like a warm bubble, and that is why we stick to the ground, not gravity. The Earth is simply moving upwards at a rate of about 10 meters a second, and that leaves us all stuck to a surface like a great glass elevator. I'm not sure if I'm buying it yet, but you know what? Let's finish this out anyway. The dome. The impenetrable dome that guards our Earth is called the Van Allen radiation belt. Maybe. The belt is just what it describes, a belt of radiation that surrounds Earth. Radiation is pure energy, like our sun. Nothing is going to pass through it. Any attempt to pass through the radiation belt will be met with the purest energy we can imagine. The radiation dome is our ceiling for now, and more than anything, it is the primary reason that we have to consider changing our consumptive ways, as the dome demands that we are staying on this Earth plane to work with one another for now. What are the sun and the moon? The sun and the moon are both magnets. The sun is an outward blasting magnet and the moon is an inward pulling magnet. They both float along magnetic meridians of the Earth plane, and when they are opposite one another, they form a yin-yang overhead the Earth plane. The moon. The visible surface of the moon is dust that has been absorbed into the magnetic surface of the moon. Like static electricity causing things to stick to us, so does the absorptive magnetic power of the moon pull in microparticles of dust. These microparticles of dust are bacterial and fungal in nature, thus the craters that are formed. Yes, the moon being made of cheese is awkward. All of the craters are the same depth on the moon, regardless of their size. This is because the density of the magnetism unites with the mass of the dust 2 to 4 miles depth. Meaning that 2 to 4 miles into the moon's surface, the dust is harder to remove and the magnetic power of the moon is overbearing. This guy put a lot of thought into this email. Now, the moon phases. The moon is a progenitor of its own light. At the core of the magnetism of the moon, the density gets so tight that the friction of the magnetism begins to illuminate. As the friction gets stronger, so does the illumination. Thus, the moon has an inner light source, and thus sometimes referred to as the black hole sun. The phases are a result of this magnetism spinning around. The sun has phases like the moon. They are just not as obvious because the sun is so bright, but both have periods of lightness and darkness. We know all I have said to be true about the light and phases because the moonlight is colder in the light than it is in the shadow. The sun. The sun is an outward flowing magnet that creates friction outwards, thus light outwards. The heat of this friction and the magnets it contains lands on us. We feel warmth. The sun is moving faster than the moon because it is outward flowing energy. 5. The cosmic microwave background. Modern science has been able to finally stake a claim in the Big Bang theory with the cosmic microwave background, or CMB, scientists have been able to measure the origin of all visible light in space. One observation they were not expecting to make was that all visible light in the universe is originated from Earth. We are the source of the Big Bang. This fact, combined with the flat Earth model, reveals a very compelling truth. Let's see, part two. Real quick. Introduction. After the perceptual chaos materializes back into a form you can comprehend, the new world we are living in is a newborn in front of our eyes, willing to grow into whatever you would like. Take notice as well from here on out that it is very pertinent that you examine the world from a logical perspective that is not run by emotion or reason, but both equally. The simplest way to do this is pick the very best answer for the problem confronted, no matter the amount of personal or external energy that need to be applied to accomplish the design. Just do it, or you will be left with an answer that is not the best. How plants grow under the magnetic sun and moon. As we most certainly know, plants need light to grow. Some of us may even know that there are different light types that are emitted from the sun and the moon, which have different effects on plant growth. The moon is an inward flowing spherical magnet whose light is caused by the inward flow of friction of magnetic particles. The light that the moon casts is blue. This blue light, which is predominant before the growing season, creates stability and structure. The plant does not grow much in this height as it does in securing itself to its surroundings. This is due to the fact that the moon is pulling energy into it. The plant's natural instinct is to pull back against the blue light and focus on the creation of structure. The sun is an outward flowing spherical magnet whose light is caused by the friction of the magnetic particles flowing out from the source of the sun at the speed of light. The light that is cast from the sun creates a red spectrum of light. This red spectrum causes plants to grow broad and tall. This is due to the fact that since they are being rained on by warmth and magnetic energy, they instinctively feel more comfortable in the warmth and grow up and out as much as possible. The seasonal cycle of moon and sun is a complete growth cycle for life. The moon is an inward accepting female energy, and the sun is the outward providing male energy. Patterns on the Earth replicate into infinity. As you continue your search for greater understanding of what's really going on around here, there is a specific visual image we would like to supply you with to increase your chances of discovering a path of truth. Anything and everything on Earth must come from a predetermined pattern. These patterns we are so familiar with, such as triangles, circles, and squares, are replicated on the very tiny scale up to the very large. The relationships between these shapes that we see in our everyday lives are the same relationships these shapes have infinitely in time and space. Take, for existence, your eyeball. Your eye is an oblate spheroid with one half of the light and the other half in the dark. The side that faces light brings in experience, and the side that faces dark processes it. Ooh. Well, the same is for the shape of the Earth. There is a dome out of the top of an oblate spheroid that we see out of, and everything below our feet is where the natural process of nature occurs. The experience. Just as shapes of the universe replicate themselves in infinite space, so does all other forms of energy, such as sounds, shapes, and even emotional energy. The Earth is a being experiencing us as its inhabitants, and we are experiencing the Earth as a place we live. When we are happy and spread love and new ideas, the Earth feels the vibrant energy that runs through our bodies and provides us with a positive feedback to increase our activity. On the other hand, when we do things that are harmful to ourselves, the Earth is directly affected by our actions. We are not the only ones who suffer from our bad habits. The Earth directly feels what we do to ourselves, and the collective whole of our habits creates the average reaction by Earth. If we are good to Earth, Earth is good to us, and vice versa. The laws of beings. We're almost done with this, by the way. Human beings, in their attempt to understand and survive the Earth, have to work with natural laws that are physically obvious, such as what goes up must come down. We also have to work with less obvious psychological laws, such as do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Then, just beyond the material and psychological laws are the laws of the essence of being, wherein we have to confront more complex behavior, such as compassion, empathy, and apathy, among others. Most spend their existence analyzing the first two types of laws, those of the physical and the immediate emotional needs. Fewer consider the long-term effects of our actions, and even fewer take the steps to accomplish change. The natural laws that exist can be manipulated for good or bad intention, the same way that temperature can be adjusted to a room, and the same way a room stays hot. If we would like the cool of the room to cool the room down, we have to take the steps to cool the place off. For what it's worth, we are being shown the truth. Even though the powers of government are a great suspect in these times and considered to be untrustworthy. Not all who hold influence over us are trying to lead us towards the end. There are thousands of artistic pieces that have been trying to show us the truth since the truth became an issue. Looking back, one can see the obviousness of which some of the parties explored the topic. Then must ask the self, was I paying attention? And this is the last part. The psychology of flat earth. The modern university of the West has shown us that there are three forms the world can take: flat, everted, and inverted. These possible viewpoints correspond directly to the possibilities the shape of the earth can take in our minds. In our minds, we can believe the earth to be flat, round, or hollow. Though, like all interpretations of reality, there is still one true reality. The planet you live on is the person you are. Those who see themselves on the planet corresponds to those who live everted, pushing outwards the magnetic flow of the self. The planet for them is a solid, impenetrable object. Like their ego, they are on Earth to thrust through the opposition with invincible determination to reach the perceived goal. Those who live on a planet are hanging on to something that is trying to spin them off. Those who see themselves on a hollow earth are inwardly absorbing the magnetic flow of the earth. For them, the intake of what is happening will be the determining factor of the outcome of the perception. Living inside of a hollow earth worldview presents one from ever seeing the true light of the sun. Those who live on a flat earth see themselves in the center of both everted and inverted views of the earth. They walk in the sunlight that is above them, on the ground that is beneath them. The ceiling is not caving in, and they're not going to fly off a spinning ball. The perception is one of balance. That's actually pretty good stuff. The four legs holding up the earth. The four legs holding up the earth are the metaphorical representation of the magnetic distribution of the earth. Our earth's magnetic sphere is as follows. The sun and the moon ride on the border of the inner circle. This is seen in the circular in and out motion of their path. The in and out aspect of their path is caused by the fluctuation in magnetism from the outer and inner circles. The sun is a spherical positive magnet flowing outward, and the moon is a spherical magnet flowing inward. The negativity and positivity can be represented with ones and zeros, or as good and bad, or as in out, or as in and out, or as one thing and another. Friction and light. As we move through time, the molecules of our existence rub together and create light. We move through the light to say hello to one another. Our conscience is existing inside of a body that is a vibrating piece of light. The rest of the world that your body lives in is a bigger vibrating place of light. The interactions of your light with the environment around you is magnetic. When you reach out and pick up a cup, you're exchanging magnetic energy with the cup, causing it to stick to your hand. The manifestation you experience in the earth realm is you grabbing a cup with all the detail of the reality you're used to. Logic and the art of submission. Living in a world that can either be viewed as flat, round, or inverted leaves us with three possible answers to any question. Yes, no, or maybe. When you answer yes, it is the confirmation. When you answer no, you are expressing rejection. And when we see maybe, we are stationary. By asking patterns of questions, we can deceive and manipulate or teach and build. The art of getting a goal or situation to submit in your favor is to get as many obstacles in the way out of the way, putting out your intention and receiving it. The moon is an inward flowing spherical magnet, like you mentioned before. When we set our psychological intention during specific moon phases, this energy is given up to the moon, wherein it is redistributed outwardly through the sun back upon the earth, where it will begin to take forth its predetermined manifest destiny. The energy that leaves the earthly realm as intention enters the moon and does not count exactly as the information entered. For the moon must filter the information in accordance with natural law. As well, when the energy flows back out of the sun, it must survive its radiance before arriving back on the earth plane. When you find yourself living on a flat earth plane, the series of emotions that run through your head are hard to get a grip on at times, as these emotions are not frequently visited with such fervency. But the reality of the world we live in has been proven by the scientific religion. They lied about the overall reality of our existence, but much of the data gathered by our university students is very true, realistic information that will stand the test of time. Such as the modern physics professor who understands that our reality is empty space, some parts covered with the haze of light to make it seem real. Anger is the losing force on Earth. At the end of the day, all beings on the planet are seeking comfort and security, two ideas which have an origin in togetherness or love. Love is the defining force of our earth. All conscience is seeking love. Chris Cox. Thanks, Chris. That's awesome. And I put a lot of time into that. So thank you. Thank you very much. Okay. Moving on. How much time I got? Oh, we still have plenty of time. Anna writes, the M&S 2016 Christmas ad, Christmas with Love from Mrs. Claus. And that's, you can look that up on YouTube. So M&S 2016 Christmas ad, Christmas with Love from Mrs. Claus. She says this becomes interesting about around the 1 minute mark. And I actually looked at that video, and what she means is at the 1 minute mark when Mrs. Claus is getting ready to leave, and it looks like she's leaving Antarctica. It doesn't look like she's leaving the North Pole. I'm pretty sure that footage was from Antarctica. The globe she's looking at is actually a flat Earth model. So interesting. Check that out when you get a chance. Ellie writes, hey Mark, in your Strange World episode 78, someone asked in an email whether the weight of a bird inside an airplane could be measured when it's flying. You did not have an answer. I believe this is the reason it cannot. When a bird flies inside an airplane, its weight would not add to that of the airplane for the same reason that you do not feel the weight of an airplane when it flies over your head. As air passes around the wings of a bird or an airplane in flight, the air molecules under the wing become effectively rigid enough to support the flying object's weight due to inertia. It's the same reason that your hand encounters resistance when you hold your hand outside the window of a moving car. Best regards, and I really enjoy your show, Ellie. Thanks, Ellie. Good point. Let's see. This one's called Meetings. If I can get to it. This one's from Daniel. Hey Mark, recently found out that the earth being flat makes sense to me. I would like to know if you have more meetings in Seattle so that I can meet like-minded people. I have a lot of other normally outrageous things that I found out through my life to share in case anyone is interested. If not, in just happy meeting smart people. Thanks, Daniel. No mixer is scheduled yet for Seattle at the moment, but I'm sure, you know, there's people out there. You'll go there are a bunch of sites, so check them out, and, you know, go just start scouring through YouTube. You will find the community and you will find people in your area, so no worries there. Moving on. This one's called Flat Earth found 1370 times in the Bible, and he doesn't actually list them all. Mike in Atlanta. Mark, everyone will find this interesting. Anyone can go to BibleCodeWisdom.com and play with the equidistant letter spacing matrix. Type in a word or a name, and the results of the embedded word throughout the Bible will come up. The spacing could be anywhere between 200 spaces between each letter of the word in an equal distant pattern. Flat Earth comes up 1370 times, often several times in the same 1 to 5 verses and in distance of less than 50 spaces. As you look through the findings, you will also notice peculiar ways in which the words were found. Sometimes they form a straight up and down pattern, but they are also found diagonally. Once I found Flat Earth in the shape of an arrow. The verses sometimes have something to do with the search words, but not always. Maybe it's just 1370 coincidences that just happen to happen. Who knows? But it is something worth looking at. Unrelated, I like the idea that one of your callers had about leaving colored post-it notes about Flat Earth in various places. Awesome. I stamp "The Earth is Flat" on the front of all my money with a self-inking stamp. And with another stamp on the back, I list YouTube channels like yours and Jaren's. Just go to. That's awesome. That's actually a great idea. I mean, not many people do as much cash, but, you know, everyone carries around some ones, I think, for things. So yeah, stamp money with Earth is Flat, or just write on it in a small corner, Earth is Flat, or write a website or something. That's awesome. That's great. Okay, who's next? This one's called First Contact, and it's from Cyrus. Dear friend, I am still in a state of shock because my childhood visions match with a world under a dome and with a God above. But on the day that I'd the vision, again, guys, you're going to write it. You probably should proofread it. I came late to school and the grown-ups punished me for coming too late because they were concerned that I was dreaming too much, and even so, my intelligence was way above others. Should wait one more year to come to school. And that's what happened. First year in school, I got good grades, but still asked too many questions. Questions no one could answer. Fundamental ones. Which led me in my teens to religion. but the religion that I found best was not very much accepted in Germany. Hinduismus. Never heard that word before. So I lost my belief in it after a period of deep practicing that. It was not possible to practice it and be part of society. Now you say one shouldn't feel free. One should feel free to contact you. I have some specific questions about what you found out and how I can check out that for myself. Please tell me how we could get together to discuss freely. It is dangerous to do or no problem until we are simple fools to the public. I'd be glad to hear from you, your German, actually Persian guy, Cyrus. Von Gmail Mobile Gissendit. I think, anyway. You know what? If you're listening to this, ask more questions. Hopefully list them out and number them and try to be specific. But before you even do that, just go into YouTube and spend some time. There's a lot of questions that are answered there by people that are making videos as good as mine, definitely. Let's see. This one's called Flyers Q&As. If you like some background on keeping secrets, I was a deckhand on the merchant ship Radium Gilbert. There's a 5-minute video village of windows. My first observation is that to date you approach the subject has been well thought out. The Q&A phone-in show with guest plus shows is with just an email response is an intelligent way with this subject matter. I was watching another video and Flat Earth got mentioned and it fit nicely into The Great Deception. Your name and Flat Earth clues came up in the video, so just had to check out. I went in a different direction in my own conspiracy research. I've been waiting for a couple of years for something to happen. It was quite a surprise. When you're thinking outside the box and someone says, look for the curve, what were the first two pitches you missed? I think it was a baseball reference. If there is a time when I could call first, just email. Just call anytime, leave a voicemail and your phone number, and I will definitely try to get back to you wherever you are. So thanks, Ian. Let's see. Patrick writes, Dear Mark, I love the hubcap earth theory. What do you think of the following idea? In particular, what would it cost? Have you ever estimated? 2 sailboats set sail from one of those small islands in the South Atlantic that belong to England. For the sake of argument, let's say South Georgia Island. It belongs to England, and you could check this out here. And he leaves the link to South Georgia. 1 sailboat sails due east, the other sails due west. Axiomatic. In both the flat earth and ball earth theories, the 2 sailboats must meet. If in the flat earth theory, the 2 sailboats meet after about 80,000 miles. In the ball earth theory, the 2 sailboats meet after approximately the circumference of Australia, which the ball earth guys claim is roughly the circumference of Antarctica. Backup planes and boats play. You know, this is a theory that I actually put forward last year, but that's fine. But it's a good one. It bears repeating. Backup planes and boats supply both sailboats with whatever their crews require, i.e. food, beverages, spare fuel, medicine, emergency provisions, etc. The 2 sailboats stay in contact and they film every inch of their respective journeys and, most importantly, their time and journeys until they meet, or shall we say, until they approximately meet, given that we don't want a collision. That would end all discussion for even more. Forevermore. Amen. What would it cost? Surely not more than $50,000. Should we start a donation campaign to run this test? We know the great powers, the United States, England, France, Germany, Russia, China, will fire on boats trying to approach Antarctica in defense of their lunatic treaty, but surely they would never fire on the sailboats traveling in the latitude of South Georgia Island, especially one that was getting attention from the alternative media and the internet. Idea is basically get on a sailboat and prove it ourselves and shut the opposition up forever. What do you think? It has to be possible, right? Best regards, Patrick O'Carroll. It's actually a good idea, but you don't even need boats to do it. I thought of doing it with boats last year, and I still think it's very, very feasible. One goes west, one goes east, and the 2 boats must meet. But you could also do it with a plane, you know, a private jet or a jet with any sort of extended range. You could do it, you could prove it out in a very, very fraction of the time. You just have one boat and one plane. You leave the boat at a stationary part, you know, within visual distance of the coast, you know, even if it's only, you know, a couple hundred miles. And then you have the plane fly in either clockwise or counterclockwise direction. Now, if the Antarctica is indeed only, you know, the same distance around as like Australia, even though from what I understood with Google Maps, it seems to be quite a bit smaller, even though on Google Maps it looks bigger. I don't know how that works out. So it should be able to circle the whole thing with a plane in what, 12, 14 hours, something like that, maybe? So in 12, 14 hours, you should run back into the boat again if it is a globe. But if it's not, then you're going to have to refuel, and you're going to have to, you know, have a second spot to go to refuel. And so you could solve it even quicker. You wouldn't, you know, if speed is the issue, and I think that's actually, you know, because boats, you got sailing conditions. In this case, you literally just have a boat just sits right there. It doesn't even have to go anywhere. And then you have the plane do all the work. I just think that they, and of course the plane has to watch the Antarctic coastline or be within visual range of it the entire time and has to ignore GPS. So it's tricky. It's a tricky thing. So anyway, thanks, Patrick. It's a good idea, though. I like it. Well, maybe someone will be able to do it. This one's from Isaac. Dear Mark K. Sargent, my name is Isaac Lee from China. I am a flat earther. Apologize of my English. It is not my first language, so I'm not going to correct it. I said that. I'm not going to correct it. I have been following Flat Earth almost 2 years and watching most of your videos, radio shows, and others' Flat Earth videos. I particularly like your video, such as Flat Earth Clues, as well as ODD TV and Jaronism. You are all using very simple but logical words to explain the Flat Earth and present us with the evidences. At the same time, I have tried to use my own words to explain the Flat Earth to people around me. You know, his English is not too bad. Lots of people I have been talked to are well-educated and strong ball earth believer. I always want to present them with a single videos that is for someone whom has here the flat earth. I take it back, his English is not super great. Flat earth for the first time. Bit like your flat earth clues series that asking questions, provide photos or video evidences, make people think. In the millions of videos from YouTube, I found different evidences, clues, proofs, debunks NASA, faking stuffs and the theories all over the place. Some is 5 minutes videos, some are hours, some is only talking about one issue, some is just too complicated for beginners. For these beginners, they won't spend too much time to watch one video unless it can caught their attention within a few minutes. Simply speaking, I am looking for a Flat Earth 101 video for ball earther that can logically organize all the questions and proofs put together as a documentary to present evidences in a simple, logical, and not too long format, also not in a religion approach. Is there a kind of video already available? If so, would you please send me some links, or is there anyone that can help to create one? Best, Isaac. From China. And I shouldn't be too hard on him for the English language is concerned, because from what I understand, compared to other languages of the world, English is very easy to learn, difficult to master, because we have a lot of, we bend our own rules. Big surprise there in America. So yeah, I will send him some links, but if you are listening to this, Isaac Lee from China, the compilation, you know, if I had to put a compilation list together, which is why I made the playlist, I would go to my channel, Mark K. Sargent, and look at the playlist called the Flat Earth Shortlist, which is about 20 videos, and I designed that specifically to give out to globalists, first-time people, and, you know, because there's a whole battery, you know, videos from 5 minutes long to 2 hours long, but it covers a broad range of perspectives from some of my favorite people. And I think, you know, and I say, you know, just pick a few of these and see what you think, and that's where I would start. So I'm going to send this guy a link to that. But I won't do it till after I'm done recording. All right, we still got plenty of time. This one's from Sean. It's called There Are No Forests on Earth and Antarctica, What's Been Right in Front of Us. Dear Mark, I've been looking at Antarctica on Google Earth near Rothschild's area for many years and have seen the ground formation, which I knew, but couldn't place where I knew this formation until I watched the video. As soon as I had my eyes open and went straight back to Google Earth, the size of that tree which fell into the sea by Rothschild's area was massive. In my mind, that tree had two branches that went across to the right, one at the top of Antarctica and one by Mexico. That tree goes all the way to Alaska. Please look at the damage this tree did to the seafloor area. This is not the only one. Just go back there everywhere, all across Antarctica. Even the Nazi Cavanista done by Hitler was into a big tree. I would love to know what you think. Many thanks, Sean. Yeah, just look give me more stuff on that. That's great. It's a great new angle. Be neat. Again, hidden in plain sight. Can't see the forest for the trees, as it were. That's really, really cool. Let's see. This one's from Danny Newman. I have been interested in the flat earth model for a few months. I went back and forth multiple times. I stumbled upon your documentary and was hooked. Good job on that. I enjoyed it greatly. I found the video claiming there's a direct flight from Sydney to Santiago and the duration of the 7,200 miles is 12 hours. That math makes sense. Apparently John Travolta owns the airline or something. That's one question. My other question is, how do seasons work in the flat earth model? Thank you in advance for your time. Best regards, Danny Newman. And I let this one in there because I get this type of email every week. So for anyone that's asking, how are their seasons? What about the flights? Just keep watching the videos. You will get the answers to many of your questions. A lot of the Q&A stuff that's out there, remember, we've been doing this now for best part of 20 months, or at least I have. And you know, for a lot of people, over a year. So there are tons of videos that cover just about every question you can ask. Just be specific. So if you're on YouTube and you have a question about the sun or the seasons or time zones or the flights, just type it in. You know, it's literally just open up with flat earth plane flights, flat earth time zones, sun rays, moon issues, whatever it is. Type it in and start looking around. But thank you, Danny R. Newman. His email handle is Danny Boy. Big shocker there. Okay, John writes, and the first, it's a quote from the title of the email is called Enoch 77, verse 1. And the first quarter of heavens is called the east because it is the first, and the second the south because the Most High descends there. And there is quite a special sense, he who is blessed forever comes down. Interesting, given the current special attention given to Antarctica and the alleged sightings of celestial objects from that vantage point. That's all he wrote. So for you, John, if you're listening, also check out the non-canonized Book of Jasher. More specifically, the end of chapter 3, the very last book of chapter 3, where Enoch is walking off the earth. He's literally walking off the earth. And he goes to a place, when he gets to the edge, of a place of ice and snow and more ice and more snow. They were really redundant about that, which is interesting because most of your biblical stuff has to do with palms and dates and deserts and sand and blazing heat and everyone dies of thirst. But he walked off a frozen place of the earth. What's that about? I think we all pretty much can get a hint there. So thank you, John, for writing that. Let's see, Jake writes, hey Mark, my name is Jake. In the last few months, I have been awakened to the flat earth from your videos. I have been talking to my stepbrother about it and convincing him to the flat side as he brought up a good point about meteors and asteroids hitting the earth. I did a little bit of research, but I haven't found a whole lot. I was just wondering if you have found anything out or what your ideas on the subject were. Thanks in advance for responding, Jake. Meteor is not a big mystery here for me. I mean, yeah, it's part of the system, no question. It's part of, we're definitely not doing it. Whoever built this place did it. But that in mind, you've got to ask yourself, you know, throw this back at your brother, stepbrother, sorry, which is, with all the meteor showers that have been happening over years and years and years, and we've had satellites supposedly up there for years and years and years, why to date, find me a satellite or that has gotten clipped, I mean tagged or glancing blow or something by a meteor shower. Why, when these meteor showers enter the atmosphere, why aren't people trying to retask their satellites to get them out of the way? Why isn't everyone just freaking out saying, by the way, there could be a lack of service because our AT&T satellite may get blown up? Nobody's, plus they even touched on this recently in the movie Gravity with Sandra Bullock and George Clooney, which is once one satellite gets spun out of control, there's a lot of them supposedly, again, if you believe the story, at the same altitude, there'll be a cascade effect and there's going to be this massive gauntlet of metal flying around. And statistics say that eventually they're all going to go. They're all going to turn into this big mess. And that's if one meteor hits just one of them and knocks them out of control because they're flying around at unbelievable speeds. And they're made out of really, really soft metal, if you believe it all. Have them answer that. Statistically speaking, we all know, you shoot a shotgun into a flock of ducks. I don't care how far of space they are. If it's a constant stream of ducks and you have an unlimited supply of ammo, you're gonna hit them eventually. It's just common sense, and nobody ever talks about it. You never hear a story about, you know, the DirecTV satellite went down today because it got hit by a micrometeor or a major meteor or anything. No, you never ever hear about it. So anyway, thank you, Jake. How many more do we have? We can do a few more. Oh, this is from DJ Grom. Hello, Mark. This is DJ Grom, Subspace Radio's only Ferengi DJ. I actually got interviewed by him last year. And it was the only interview where people complained to me in emails, because what he did was, and I didn't hear this, he actually added it after the fact, he played the original Star Trek fight scene music from the 60s music constantly in a loop in the background when I was talking. Now, I did not hear this, but he added it after the fact. So it increased the stress levels when you're listening to it a great deal. Oh, can you imagine that for an hour? Ooh, that's rough. I hate listening to it for 2 minutes. I saw your link recently about the hexagon pattern on Saturn's North Pole. I'm sure you're familiar with it. I'm not a graphics or a game designer, but if that's all just CGI imagery, do you think that early 3D models may have accidentally had the hexagon showing due to the hardware constraints of the past, and they had to embrace it and go with it? I don't know much about polygons and spheres, so I'd like to hear your take on it. I've never understood the hex on Saturn, and it looks impossible. By the way, dill pickle chips are awesome. You're lucky, lucky, lucky you're in Canada, and you should cherish every bite. Ketchup chips are for children. Don't eat those. That's funny. And remember, there's no Canada like French Canada, and it's the best Canada. It's French Canada. That must be a song over there in Montreal. Keep up the good work. Your close personal friend, DJ Grom, who I hardly ever hear from. Be sure to listen to The Neutral Zone with DJ Grom every Tuesday at 8 o'clock Eastern on subspaceradio.net. Thank you, DJ Grom. He actually puts the teeth in. I don't know if he's actually in costume when he's doing the interview, but it's all animated inside a game, the Star Trek game, inside Deep Space Nine, Quark's Bar. He is actually there doing a broadcast and he interviews people. So, kind of fun. Hopefully he'll ditch the music. Hopefully he has by now, but if he hasn't, it's not a huge deal. Let's get through a few more. This one's from Donovan. Hey, Mark, noticed you on YouTube having a conversation with the Merchant Marine. I already believed in the flat Earth prior to this. The reason I'm contacting you is because I've been observing the Earth ever since my discovery. My uncle is big on constellations. Again, spell checker, proofread after you're done, and can see the all-seeing eye stretch across the sky at certain times of the year. That made me think. Since then, I've made observations that you can clearly tell that the Earth is not rotating with the naked eye. I feel like it's time to put NASA to rest. Oh, and he put a dollar sign where the S is in NASA. That's actually pretty good. And show the world the truth. Please contact me back. It would be nice to have a discussion with someone like you about the observations I've made. Donovan. Thanks, Donovan. Oh, this one's from Emily, I think. Hi, my name is Emily, and I am from New Jersey. I am 28 years old. I recently watched your Flat Earth Clues documentary. For quite some time now, maybe the past 8 years or so, I have taken initiative to educate and open myself to many different topics that are not presented through mainstream information. Everything from God to aliens in the universe, the government and the elitist, Illuminati and the NWO, GMOs, and veganism, Flat Earth theory, and millions of conspiracy theories. So wrapped up, I have even watched conspiracy theories on conspiracy theories, I'm sure you know. I consider myself awake and capable of thinking for myself and making my own decisions based on instinct and not the need to conform, and for that I am grateful and proud. I truly believe I am awake enough not to believe a word that is fed to us by our authority, yet acquire enough common sense to not feed into and fester in everything I see on a random YouTube documentary. I am also grounded and aware enough to know or believe, I don't even really know if I could undoubtedly say, that there is true basis for common sense, considering my strong feelings of doubt towards a lifelong and genuine subjection to what has been enforced upon me or us to be the norm or the truth. Oh, she says a mouthful. I feel I fall into the category of really knowing nothing at all. I feel I am a soul on this earth with emotion, compassion, feelings, imperfections, and most importantly, an open mind. Yet I don't know why or how, and after watching your documentary, not even sure where I am. I believe it very well could be possible that, as you stated in your video, everything we have ever been thought from the moment we were born is a flat-out BS lie. I have more faith in that theory than anything. It's all very trippy. She was very eloquent, and then she throws in the word trippy. Giving your age away. She was 28. Where's she from? I took a lot away from your video. It was very powerful for me. I went to Catholic school my whole life, raised as a Catholic. However, I cannot say I am a religious person or have any real beliefs or faith regarding the subject. With that being said, I am not opposed to it, especially after doing research on the forbidden flat earth. I'm not going to sit here and say I believe it 100%, but my mind is open to it and appreciate the information you and the others like you put forward. I guess I have always had more of a belief in the universe and science as opposed to a belief in the Bible and a creator such as God. Your video was so intriguing to me. I honestly cannot stop thinking about it. I do truly believe everything and anything is possible, and I don't actually know anything for a fact as a human here on Earth. I guess some would call that a lack of faith, but I can't help it. It's how I think and feel. With all of that being said, I did just really want to ask you two questions. I guess There are more personal questions in regards to your actual beliefs. My first question, do you believe in other dimensions? Yes, I do. Or do you completely rule out the idea of anything beyond the Earth, such as a galaxy and outer space and cosmos? Well, I don't think there's spaces we know it. I don't think it's an empty space outside. I do think there's something outside the Earth, but I don't think it's this empty vacuum-filled blackness. Not at all. I think it's the opposite. Or life form of other planets. I do believe in other life forms, but not on the planets we're shown. Aliens of any type or planets at all? Planets, no. But alien things flying around in ships, other previous civilizations, yes, I do. Please do not think I am mocking you in any type of way. I am just so curious and maybe even a little confused as to what the whole flat earth theory truly means. You had said the sky and stars were placed here for us. Yes, I did. Are there other creations like us out there? Why wouldn't there be? You know, if you're not going to, this is not just a one-off. Or like I said, nothing beyond this earth. I would love to know your thoughts. My second question has to do with global warming. Do I believe in it? Yes, I do. But if it's an automated system, if it's an enclosed system, it could just be the global warming is trying to compensate for it. So if you have like a camping lantern, you know, like a heating propane thing inside a car, and you've got the air conditioning running against it, you know, it's going to compensate for it. You know, try to deal with it in one way or the other. I definitely do feel we have significant damage to our Earth that cannot be argued, of course, but with your theory, is there an outer layer of our Earth that is being diminished and destroyed, changing our climate and our natural flow of our life, or is that ruled out as well? I think we are altering it in some way. Of course, I also think that HARP and any sort of artificial weather modification systems have some sort of kickback, some sort of blowback, meaning if you decide you're going to put a hurricane somewhere using artificial means, I mean, we are, the system is still going to try to compensate for it. It's going to create weird weather in a different place to try to balance things out. The more you do it, the worse it gets. So whatever government's working on that, you might want to be a little careful. Thank you for taking the time to read this. Sorry if I ramble a little bit. I normally do not share what goes on in my mind. Lately, I've been feeling extra confused though, so it felt good to write a little of it down. Again, thank you for reading and for the time and effort you put in trying to make a world a better place. Hopefully I hear back from you, Emily. So thanks, Emily. That was awesome. And let's see if we can do one more. And then we'll call it. This one's from Marty from the Ozark Outdoors. Hey Mark, I think I've read something about the moon gradually moving away from the Earth. Something about the reflectors the astronauts put there and a big old laser here on the ball Earth, shining on it and timing the bounce back. BS, I know, but bear with me. They're being nassholes. Also say, he stole that from George Carlin. Also say that this month's supermoon is close to the moon, closest it's ever been since 1948. So if it's constantly moving away and it's been there forever, how can it be closer now than in 1948? Anyway, just food for thought. But if it is circling a flat earth, maybe its height changes periodically. Look into the Book of Enoch. And maybe the sun does also. Maybe that's part of why some years are hotter than others and some colder than others. The moon does appear large at times, which leads me to believe its elevation is changing at times. But it's hard to look at the sun to tell if its size gets bigger or smaller over the years. But it could explain the climate changes a lot better than the dreaded greenhouse gases. Greenhouse, kind of like a terrarium, a glass dome over land and water, Operation Fishbowl. They rub it in our faces and say we're crazy when we call them on it. Screw NASA. I can't believe I ever fell for any of their crap, but my eyes are open now. Thanks for all the info and helping to get the truth out and keep it flat. Marty. You know what? We're going to end it on that. Keep it flat, guys.